Hello and welcome to this Love Audio event. For those of you who don't know me, I am Ann Piper, Head of Client Partnerships at Spotify. Thank you for joining us for this session dedicated to the exciting and somewhat nuanced world of podcast advertising. What you have just seen are some of the announcements we made during our Stream On event a couple of months ago, which highlight what's next for Spotify and the future of audio. With today's session, we want to get the chance to dive deeper into those latest innovations and discuss with you how Disney can make the most of this opportunity. What I'm really excited about is the mission and the goal and the partnerships between our two companies. And I wanna tell you a quick story. Today I drove my two sons to school. So I have a sixth and seventh grader, Jack and Jeffrey. They're 12 and 13. So Gen Z, here they come. And I started to tell them, hey, today, when you come home from school, can you please be quiet? Because I'm going to be on a call with Disney. And they said, oh, Mom, Loki launches today. And oh, my God, tell them that we love Mandalorian. And yeah, OK, Marvel, too. Just tell them that we love it all. And thank you to Disney. And so I tell you that story because it really made me smile, because I think about my childhood and loving Disney as I grew up or stepped first foot at Disneyland, to growing up now and watching The Last Dance and really thinking about my childhood, watching basketball with my dad and all the things that Disney has to offer. I also read The Ride of a Lifetime during quarantine, and I just couldn't believe the power and boldness and tenacity and resilience of this organization. And as you approach 100 years, I think about Spotify as that next partner to think about getting you through innovation into the next 100 years. And so what does that really look like with our two organizations working together? That means we're in, you know, over 40 countries together, and the power of our two organizations in terms of studio work to what we do from, you know, the media networks to everything that's going on across all your platforms, the opportunity for the two of us to work together is really endless. And so, you know, today our playlist really consists of some key areas. So we're going to highlight some podcast industry insights for you. We're gonna explore the latest innovation in the podcast ad space. We're gonna share some creative best practices for you to take, you know, advantage of this format. And then we're really excited about the fireside chat with Courtney Holt, who's our VP of Global Studios and Video and a former EVP of Advanced Media Strategy at Disney. And really it's about the power of and the next wave of storytelling through audio. And then we've got some really exciting prizes at the end. We're going to be reviewing your own listening trait, this group's listening traits. So if you could take a look at this slide and scan the QR code from this slide or connect your Spotify account or click on the link in the chat. Speaking of chat, we want to make sure that this is an interactive session for you. So I want to call attention to the features that there's a box on the bottom of the screen to submit questions to the speakers, which will be addressed at the end of the session. Thank you all again for your partnership, and I'm excited to turn the next session over to Nick Stilwell.
Hey everyone, my name is Nick Stilwell, one of the client partners that works on our Walt Disney partnership here at Spotify. And I'm here to talk about the rise of audio and give you an inside view. So truly, we've reached a critical inflection point for digital audio. And this has really occurred over the last couple of years with a few very important events. First, starting in 2019, eMarketer announced that for the first time, time spent on mobile had overtaken time spent on television. And then the following year in 2020, eMarketer went a step further and they announced that within mobile, time spent on audio was the number one medium, surpassing social media, video, and gaming. And then we see today on the current numbers from 2021 that this trend has really only continued. We see that time spent on mobile is now upwards of almost 4 hours a day, surpassing television. And the trend has continued with streaming audio being the dominant format on those mobile devices. And this time spent on mobile is only continuing to grow. When we look at Comscore's top 100 mobile properties, we see that Spotify is number one at the top for average time spent. This is, again, ahead of other social media platforms, streaming services, and video platforms alike. So where we are today is that Spotify truly has become the world's most popular audio streaming platform. We're in 178 markets worldwide. We recently launched in over 80 just this year. We see 356 million monthly active users, 97 million US unique visitors, over 70 million music tracks on the platform, and over 4 billion playlists created by both Spotify and individual users. We see 2.6 million podcasts available to stream on the platform. And of course, all of this is in a brand safe, clutter-free advertising environment. So now I'm going to talk about the value of podcast advertising, which is really why we're here today. Podcasts are mainstream. They've been at the center of audio's renaissance. And we see today that 118 million, nearly one in three Americans, are listening to podcasts every single month. Listeners are spending over 40 minutes per day listening to podcasts, and this number is only continuing to grow. So what's fueling this? Well, a huge part of it is that podcast creation is booming. Like I mentioned, we have over 2.6 million podcast titles available to stream on Spotify and over 400 original and exclusive podcasts that Spotify is either producing itself or directly licensing with creators. And so over the last few years, what Spotify has really done is keyed in on four focus areas to build out our world-class audio-first advertising platform. The first area of focus, of course, is listeners, 356 million global listeners. The second is servicing creators through a variety of different tools to fuel the next generation of podcast creators and storytellers through our partnerships or through our platforms like Anchor and Megaphone, which works with third-party premium publishers, to our most recent acquisition, Locker Room, which is really going to fuel the next generation of what live audio looks like. The third is, of course, content. We have our Spotify Studios in-house team, and we have our three Spotify studios that we've acquired, The Ringer, Gimlet, and Parcast. And then we also have our exclusive licensing deals with podcast creators like The Joe Rogan Experience, most recently announced Armchair Expert, Barack and Michelle Obama, and many more. And then the fourth area, of course, is monetization and everything that Spotify is doing through our advertising team. And we know that podcast advertising is super important because our podcast audience acts. They're over twice as likely to be highly receptive to ads and podcasts over television. And 81% of podcast listeners report having taken an action after hearing a podcast ad. And that's especially true for entertainment brands, which is really, really valuable for the Walt Disney Company. We see that 65% of Spotify podcast listeners say they're likely to try movies or shows if Spotify suggested them. And 56% of millennial Spotify free listeners say they've discovered a new show or movie based on a playlist they listen to. And finally, 53% of Spotify free listeners believe that advertising helps remind them of movies or shows that they haven't seen. And so also within this, we know that podcasts offer the ability to reach the unreachables. In addition to reaching Spotify premium listeners, we know that one in three of all cord cutters listen to podcasts. We also know that Spotify podcast listeners are 32% more likely to use ad-free video streaming services. And 62% of podcast listeners use ad blockers on the web. So all of this creates an incredible opportunity for incremental reach to really hard to find really hard to find audiences. So now I'm going to pass it over to Alex Lung, who's going to talk to you about the Spotify Audience Network.
Great. Thanks, Nick. Hi, everyone. My name is Alex Lung. I'm on Spotify's monetization product marketing team and lead our podcast efforts. I've been really fortunate to have incubated our podcast business from the ground up and have led the go-to-market launches for both our streaming ad insertion ad technology and the recent launch of the Spotify Audience Network. Before I jump into the Spotify Audience Network, I wanted to quickly highlight an advertiser perception survey conducted in Q4 20, where they asked podcast advertisers which podcast advertising buying method works best for achieving KPIs. The top two responses by a wide margin were by audience segment and across podcast network. And that's part of why we're so excited about the potential of the Spotify Audience Network. We believe that podcast advertising will ultimately scale with the Spotify audience, will ultimately scale with audience-based buying, because we believe for advertisers, content is really just a means to an end, which is speaking to potential customers. So as you saw at the top, we introduced the Spotify Audience Network at our company-wide event Stream On back in February. The launch of the Spotify Audience Network was our headline advertising announcement that day. So what is the Spotify Audience Network? It's an audio-first advertising marketplace that offers audience-based buying across our network of podcasts that now includes leading third-party podcast publishers. On the right-hand side, you can see that our network includes podcasts from our four studios, Spotify Studios, The Ringer, Gimlet, and Parcast, as well as leading third-party podcast publishers like Viacom, CBS, The Wall Street Journal, and Vox. Our advertising partners will be able to target listeners leveraging easy-to-use audience-based targeting tools like demographic targeting, geographic targeting, and audience segments, with all of the media delivered within a highly engaging podcast environment, both on and off Spotify. So really, this image is really meant to capture the audience marketplace, the advertising marketplace, with publishers and creators on one side and advertisers on the other. This is really all with the mission of connecting millions of advertisers with billions of listeners. So advertisers right now really have four ways to reach their target audience, either by demographics, geographics, audience segments, and content categories. We've got really compelling segments that may be of interest to Disney, like entertainment enthusiasts, moviegoers, streamers, comedy enthusiasts, family enthusiasts, et cetera. And we also have ways to contextually target by content category. Our top categories include business and finance, comedy, entertainment and lifestyle, news and politics, and sports. Ultimately, we believe the Spotify Audience Network represents a really compelling advertising opportunity for advertisers. It offers meaningful listener reach and scale, extending the reach of advertisers across our network of podcasts that now includes leading third-party podcast publishers. We can offer audience-based buying, allowing advertisers to hone in on their target audience across a highly engaging podcast environment. And finally, the Spotify Audience Network unlocks access to premium content from our four podcast studios and across leading third-party podcast publishers. With that, I'd like to pass it back to Nick to walk you through what a potential Spotify Audience Network campaign could look like for Disney.
Thanks, Alex. We had to focus on Loki. Today is the day for Disney Plus. Congrats to the team on the launch of the series. And we wanted to give you a real-time example, like Alex mentioned, of what the Spotify Audience Network can really offer for a campaign like this. So focusing on three campaign objectives, we know that a partner like Disney Plus, of course, wants to drive mass appeal, awareness, and streams for Loki on Disney Plus. We also know that they want to drive subscriptions. And lastly, we know that it's critical to drive the Marvel narrative to key audiences of value. So looking at our targeting selection on the right and all the opportunity that we have within our Spotify Audience Network, we included a few examples of what a campaign could look like from an audience standpoint. Focusing on streaming audiences, we know it's likely important to focus on broad demos and reach. Demos like adults 18 to 49 and audiences like SVOD streamers and cord cutters. We also know that Marvel and Disney fans are critical for a campaign like this. So going a bit more niche, we would focus on adults 18 to 34 for a key demo. We would also focus on Marvel series viewers, Disney parks visitors, and Disney Plus streamers. Again, all tapping into the Nielsen audiences that are available in the Spotify Audience Network. And then going a bit more niche, there's the opportunity to key in even further, focusing on individual demos like females 18 to 49, and audiences like moms of high school children and crime TV fans, which is a genre that's very important for this type of series. There's truly endless opportunity, and we're really excited to bring these solutions to the table for the entirety of our Walt Disney partnership. So now I'm going to pass it over to Tristan O'Donnell, who's going to talk about creativity and podcast advertising.
Thanks, Alex and Nick. Now you know where and how your audience will hear your message. I'm here to talk to you about what they'll hear from your brands. I'm so excited to talk to you about creativity and podcast advertising. According to our research, people listen to podcasts for three main reasons. First is to stay up to date. Second is to be entertained. And third is to learn new things. There's so much that podcasts have to offer. And as Nick stated earlier, Spotify listeners consume a multitude of them with different intentions for streaming. So keep these reasons in mind. Next, consider how to connect with podcast listeners in their audio routine. Just as people use music to soundtrack their daily lives, people use podcasts similarly. So think about the activities your audience engages in while they listen to podcasts. I like to listen to podcasts on a long run or while cooking, but for others on the call, it might be during family time, or those of you residing in LA while you're behind the wheel and in some traffic. Think about how your audience might be tuning in so that you can tailor the message, not just to the medium, but the potential listening context. And then lastly, determine the voice of your ad. A brand really needs to make three key decisions to identify the right podcast creative strategy. Do you want to run your ad in a very specific type of content? Do you want your ad to run against a specific audience at scale? Or do you want total control over the message or prefer a show's creative team to direct? Either way, Spotify creates the opportunity to let you be heard. So in determining your podcast ad strategy, we can help you find the heart of what the message is you're trying to spread by aligning it to the innovative products and packages we have available. With a best-in-class production team, we're changing the game in audio storytelling. And no TV commercial is one and the same, so we've applied that same logic to the podcast ad. Pictured here is how we lay out the formats we have available based on what I shared earlier regarding show focus, scale focus, and creative direction. As you can see, it's a wide variety of creative formats on top of a traditional host read ad that truly run the spectrum. For example, unscripted reads can be done quickly, read by a host in a show focus, while custom creative mid-roll might not feature a host reading your spot, but it does incorporate voice talent, sound design, and we can really get creative with your IP within a category rather than a single show. So you don't sacrifice scale for creativity. I also want to note that we have a format made for entertainment partners just like you, called embedded clip reads, which means we can wrap your licensed content with scripting to make for a seamless integration. Our tactics and creative formats paired with Spotify Audience Network are a truly winning combination. Now make sure you lean in close and that your headphones are charged or plugged in. Let's listen together to get a sense of what podcast ads sound like on Spotify. So first, an example of an unscripted read, great for brand marketing, host tested and products moved. If you're looking to increase awareness for a suite of content, you can build buzz around your brands where select hosts can interact and establish credibility among a dedicated audience who trusts their favorite podcast host just like a friend. Here's an example of an unscripted read from Bill, who is the perfect spokesman to talk about Peacock's library of sports content.
All right, before we bring in Deezus and Samara, let me tell you about Peacock, the new streaming service from NBC Universal. Great news, great entertainment. Finally free, Peacock has live sports, daily highlights, timely docuseries, exclusive access to Premier League and more. Check out live events, including the 2021 Premier League season with over 175 exclusive matches live streamed on Peacock. Timely updates with sports talk from Mike Florio, Dan Patrick, Rich Eisen. And then my dudes, Michael Smith and Michael Holly. Good to see them back together again. Some Boston guys. They have a show as well called Brother from Another. Peacock, the exclusive streaming destination of the 2021 Olympics. You can find great documentaries there about untold stories of grit, perseverance, triumph behind the athletes we love. Because why not? Why not watch more TV right now? What else are you going to do? I am a huge Peacock fan because they have a great library of movies. And there's especially some great stuff from the 70s and 80s as well. Go check that out. Best of streaming, best of TV. Watch for free and upgrade for more on your TV, tablet, or phone. Go to peacocktv.com to download and start streaming. Right now, let's bring in.
Bill was the perfect spokesman for NBC to build awareness for Peacock and highlight its library of engaging sports content. As you can hear, Bill is conversational and approachable in his voiceover, and he shares his own personal love of great stories and the history of the game. Next, we have custom creative mid-roll with voice talent. You can get creative while exercising control over the final audio spot with conceptual creative that stands out at scale. Our most premium voice talent format is like a TV commercial, but for your ears. Features thematic alignment with show categories, one or more casted voices, and sound design. This format is ideal for brands that want custom or first-to-market solutions. So let's listen together to a clip from The Two Princes for LEGO.
This episode of The Two Princes is brought to you by LEGO City. Welcome to LEGO City. Population, you, and your imagination. Can you hear the ocean? Right now, we're inside the LEGO City Ocean Exploration Submarine, a powerful deep-sea sub with everything you need for adventure. Explore the ocean with the sub's two mechanical arms. Examine the ocean floor with an underwater drone. Or search the coral-covered cave for hidden treasure. Watch out for the glowing anglerfish. If you can dream it, you can build it on the high seas of LEGO City. Check out all of the sets, including the Ocean Exploration Submarine, at lego.com/city.
So as you could hear, LEGO was looking to highlight their City Ocean playset, and they worked with our team to recruit new builders through an exciting sonic journey into an immersive underwater world. Mid-roll takeover. This is the opportunity to connect with content audiences accept and love from their favorite podcasts. You can work creatively with hosts to develop a thematic tie to their shows and find ways to weave in your brands. Our most premium format offers the most authentic integration with a show and a bold way to be heard. I'm going to play you a clip right now from Dissect. Aligning with season 7 of Dissect's editorial focus on Childish Gambino, Cole the host dissects how This Is America, one of his most popular songs, saw a resurgence on TikTok alongside the Black Lives Matter movement. Let's listen to a clip together.
Season 7 of Dissect is brought to you by TikTok. In our last segment, we detailed how Childish Gambino's This Is America saw a resurgence on TikTok as a score to the current moment in America. Today, we're diving into the song's production to understand why its unique musical setting attracted so many creators and viewers alike. This Is America begins with a quaint finger-plucking guitar and rich gospel-inspired vocals, a fusion of country, blues, and gospel of the American South, specifically alluding to genres created by Black Americans. But then, seemingly out of nowhere, This Is America transitions to a sinister contemporary beat, complete with a dark, growling bass line and trap-style drums.
This is America. Don't catch you slipping, no.
Side by side, the bright, folksy production and the contrasting, menacing beat captures the duality of America itself, its beauty, its danger, and its historical exploitation of its Black citizens. This duality, of course, is paired with the song's refrain, "This is America," a concise, definitive statement, yet one that's ambiguous enough to allow the listener to fill in the blank of what exactly this is. Creators on TikTok recognize this ambiguity, and the content of their videos, scored by This Is America, offered a perspective of what this is, ultimately displaying the spectrum of what it means to be American. In our next segment, we'll dive deeper into This Is America's lyrics and video. Be sure to follow me on TikTok at Dissect Podcast and share with me your favorite videos. You can discover emerging artists and find the latest trends, music, and videos just for you. It starts on TikTok.
Now you know how podcast ads can sound, and hopefully gears are turning for how Disney can really win in the podcast ad space on our platform. We look forward to working with you on all of your future campaigns. So now I'm excited to pass the mic to Elena Sulzer, Spotify's Category Development Officer for Entertainment.
Thanks, Tristan. What a great setup from the team to introduce our special guest today. Before we get started with Courtney, I wanted to remind everyone to put questions in the Q&A box. Tom Henry, our entertainment sales director, is going to be monitoring the chat in the Q&A, and we'll make sure to get to as many of the questions you have covered. Courtney, we're super excited to have you here talking to the Disney teams today. We think you're the perfect person to dive deeper into the audio landscape and why Spotify is the ideal partner. First, it would be great if you could do a quick intro for those who might not know about your background.
Sure. I really am honored to be here. Obviously, it was a real honor to work at Disney, and I'm thrilled to be able to talk about what I've been doing since I left. And I'm sorry, my head looks weird. It seems like the background is doing my dome. So prior to joining Spotify, I worked in Disney corporate. I worked for Kevin Mayer doing what was called advanced media strategy, which was basically laying the foundation for different ideas that ultimately Disney has picked up on the Disney Ad Network and also on some of the Disney Plus early stage conversations, which was really rewarding. I arrived at Disney through an acquisition in Maker Studios, which I was the chief operating officer of, and then got to run for a little bit within Disney. And before that, I'd worked in media. I'd worked at Viacom, Fox, and at Universal Music. So I've done a lot of media, and I've always been on the digital side. So I've sort of been in and out of these evolutionary conversations for such a long time. When I came to Spotify, my role was really to focus on building a business outside of music for Spotify. And so podcasting was the first thing that we worked on. And now I can say that there are five businesses that we have between podcast music live, which is forthcoming. And then we also have paid content feeds. And then we're also starting to work on increasing the video capabilities, primarily not to make a video for the sake of video, because Disney's pretty darn good at that. And so is YouTube. And we're not going to be better than those two. So in many cases, we think about video being a way to distribute audio in a new world. And a lot of audio is combined with video on platforms like YouTube, and even podcasters are doing video as well. And we think the idea of those glanceable moments or being able to look and listen is just an extension of the great work that the team has been doing over the last few years.
We're so lucky to have you. It's such a great background. I'd love for you, as a first question, to kick off on, since you came from Disney and we're talking to the Disney family here, what's like a fun memory from working at Disney that you'd like to share?
You know, it's never lost on me how incredible Disney is at building, growing, and defending franchises. And I was lucky enough to be there when the first Star Wars reboots were happening, and you saw the scale of power in Marvel and beyond. And I think Disney just consistently understands what brands mean and the value of protecting those brands. And so I learned a lot about integrity, and I learned a lot about brand development, and I learned a lot about franchise development. And I carry a lot of that into the work that I do here, because as we started from effectively nothing, and we didn't have content as a part of our DNA. And I will say it's hard for a technology company to understand how to be in the media business. So I'm so thankful I got to work at the best media company and learn how to think about both media and technology from a brand lens. And that is applied in everything I do every day since I worked at Disney, and I'll carry it forward in everything I do in the future. It just was like an education you just can't get unless you're part of the organization. And I got a silver pass. That was fun.
Totally. I'm sure that's one of everybody's favorite perks. Okay, well, let's get into the meat of the conversation. Podcasts have seen such tremendous growth over the last few years. So what do you think the main drivers are behind that growth? And then what makes Spotify so well positioned in the space?
So I think it's sort of odd because I didn't know anything about audio, really. My background was in video and in music. And so when I came here, I'm like, we got to figure out audio. And I think what I learned over the last couple of years, and I think it's sort of like the where podcasts are, then there was the pandemic. And so there's a bunch of different factors. But I think that what's really interesting when you think about podcasting, it really is the best of lots of different types of mediums put together for you in a new form. And sometimes it's what is old is new again. So radio was a great format. And if you go back to the 50s, the golden age, people would sit in their living room in front of a speaker. And that was a real great communal moment. By the way, when people pitch me that, I'm like, there's a reason we don't do that anymore. But the modern version of that is that you can be listening to intimate voices and hearing great stories or hearing or being taken on a journey. It can be doing it while you're doing something else. You could be on a hike or a walk, or you could be jogging, or you could be exercising, and you could be cooking, you could be traveling, you could be commuting. And the great thing is like podcast is adjacent and can fit seamlessly into your life in a way that terrestrial radio couldn't, or effectively got too dumb to do. And I don't mean terrestrial radio is dumb, but I mean like the mechanism for, you know, the band that's in your car. My car doesn't have a radio dial anymore. You know, we're living in an app universe. You have to make a choice. And when you're pushing 19 minutes of advertising an hour and a playlist, it's very hard for younger people to engage. What we found is that storytelling in the ear, and that's a combination of mobility and obviously of earphones, of personal listening devices, it becomes really intimate. I also think that you could look at podcasting as a form of social media. And I think that's an important distinction, because when you think about media types, we often think about social media as sort of ephemeral and traditional media as sort of permanent. And what podcasting is a little bit of permanence in social media. Because when you think about a show like Serial, that's a document that will live forever on an incredible story being told in a way that brings intimacy and, you know, real personalities to the forefront. I think the evolution of podcasting, and I think this is where I think we've been best situated to move this forward, is we thought about audio as a business. And by the way, not just a business that Disney can participate in as a marketer, but Disney is participating in podcasting from an original content perspective. And there's an evolutionary opportunity to bring more of the Disney brands into audio. And I think that's going to be really important. This is about building presence and habit and also aligning with great creative people. I also think you can build really great predictable, communication. And you think about someone like a Brené Brown. Brené Brown is like become that much more important over the last year as a voice that's dealing with a lot of the issues that we all have dealt with being locked down in the way that we are. But I also think she's just somebody who now has the power in her platform that's unique, that most, I can't remember any other medium that had that degree of power. And it also is global. We're not just seeing this be a relevant market in the US. We're seeing, you know, I have 10 studio organizations built around the world covering over 20 markets, making original content and distributing exclusive content. And so it's very interesting when we look at, like, radio wasn't a global medium, but in what we're doing, we have IP that's being developed in India and in Chile that's actually resonating in the US and vice versa. And we can obviously organize the commercialization around that of the audience segmentation and of the region, which I think is really great for a brand like Disney that is a global brand company, and we are a global distributor of content. And we're a platform that also understands what it means for premium content and brands to work collaboratively. You know, I was in the tough position having worked within the YouTube ecosystem to go to Disney, and I was one of the people that was responsible to rethink the brand safety around broadly distributed advertising on platforms like YouTube. And at that point in time, we even did, I think, our first Spotify upfront buy, because it was about building adjacency to content where it's predictable and controlled. And yes, there's podcasts that Disney brand would not fit nicely with. But if you look at your portfolio, it's like aligning ESPN with a lot of our sports programming, aligning studios with various programs that'll appeal to kids, moms, young adults, and even older demographics. I think there's a lot that we can do, and we just know how important that conversation is to be in the middle of. And it's a hard thing to, and I think also if you look at the brand advertising and podcasting thus far, most of it was DR, it wasn't well produced, and it wasn't well positioned. And I think a lot of that was technology, because there's only so much you can do by distributing podcast advertising over technology like DAI. And I'm not discounting DAI as not viable, but it lacks the same amount of predictability as we can do through SPAN, through our audience network, and through SAI. And I think the combination of reach and targeting is something that only Spotify can actually deliver on. And a large part of that was, you know, how do you bring the architecture of what works in advertising into audio in a meaningful way and builds on the Spotify proposition? And I think we've done a really good job of that. But I think we can really prove it to you in partnership of doing a lot more together.
I totally agree. And I'm sorry, right? When I'm speaking, there's a big truck cleaning, street cleaning going by me right now. So sorry if that's a little loud. I know you touched on this a little bit, but I think everybody would love to hear a little bit more on, you know, it's really easy to make a podcast, but how it's not easy to make a successful podcast, and would love to hear your thoughts a little bit more on what makes, like, what's the consideration you and your team are taking, like looking at when you're thinking about making a successful podcast?
Well, I think it's interesting because this actually will even hit one of the questions that came through, which is like, we're a distributor of over 3 million podcasts today. And the podcast ecosystem is really broad. So much like anybody could create a YouTube channel, we've seen the democratization of audio, and it started with podcasting, which still wasn't that hard to do. Anybody could use GarageBand, make an audio file. You'd have to find a host, then you could upload that. And like, we've made it easier by tools like Anchor, and also just by generally letting Spotify be a place that podcasters can distribute their content. And it's not in lieu of Apple or other partners. It's just one of many places that you can put your podcast. What's been really interesting about, I think, what I've seen at Spotify is that we're measuring the audience that's listening on who actually listens. And I'm not going to flag this data for y'all, but you can look it up on that, what percentage of the downloads on other services are actually played. Part of that is some liabilities and challenges in just how you traffic things like DAI across networks and services you can't control. For us, we're going to give you real measurement, let you know who's listening, and be really clear on that. So I think a large part of it is just the evolution of the space is now affording a new type of communication between consumer and creator. But the creators that get it are the ones that actually put in the time and the work, because it's not just making an audio file and distributing it. You have to build a connection with the audience, and it takes time. Using my social media analogy, if you were promoting a Disney brand on a social network, let's pick Instagram, and you put up 8 photos over 8 weeks, how well do you think the engagement's going to be? The point is you have to feed it to grow it. And a large part of people think like, I'll just make a podcast and I'll do 8 episodes and I'll go through my Rolodex. And that's not really a way to engage an audience. You have to really think about what are you bringing to the table? And it requires a certain amount of intimacy that I think sometimes people don't consider. And I think that, I think there are some mediums where the interview is set up to make the guest look really, really important. The best podcasts, like someone like Dax Shepard, he's as much a part of the dialogue as is the guest. And so it's bringing together a shared experience and audio and feeling like you're part of a community or a club by being present. That's going to be the most important thing to get it right. And it is hard work.
Yeah, I can see that. And Dax is amazing. So fun to listen to. Tom, did you want to come in with some questions from the Q&A box?
Sure. Some questions coming in from Q&A. First one that popped up is, Courtney, for you, what is the future of audio, and where do you think the industry will be in 3 to 5 years, given the recent explosion of growth that we've seen in the audio space?
You know, what's great is like when I got to Spotify, I think only about 10% of the US population consumed podcasts. And I think podcasts was even relevant in, let's call it, 5 international countries. Now we're seeing global growth. We participated in a podcast festival in Africa recently, and it was really cool to see like the different types of audiences and different types of content that are developing on a global basis. What I think is really cool is like, it's about understanding each individual market, each audience, and that direct connection. And we've done a lot of work to really look at data to analyze what connects with what. But we have this great benefit in that I'm seeing, you know, the global podcast ecosystem in addition to the things that we are making. So it gives us a little bit of advantages in both. In terms of the future of the evolution, number one, y'all need targeting measurement. You need to know who's listening, and you need to know what they're connecting with, and you need to see the results from your brand being adjacent to the right content. That's the commercial side. On the creative side, I think we're gonna see some interesting evolutionaries. We're launching a live platform. And what I think is unique about the way I'm looking at live is I don't think about live as an ephemeral use case. I don't think it's about creating a live democratized social network for audio. I think what we're trying to do is figure out a way for live programming to bring the best of open conversations and experiences into the audio space. Because in podcasting, you really couldn't create a connection between creator and audience except for the feed and social media adjacent to it. I think we're going to do some interesting experiments to bring things together. And as someone who's a big sports fan, I've been jumping into Locker Room, which is the platform that we acquired, and I'm watching what's happening. Unfortunately, I'm a Clippers fan. Last night was heartbreaking, but it's game one. But I was in the room listening to people like debate out the game, and it's kind of fun to participate in a conversation. It feels live and it feels present, but I could grab a mic and say something, and I felt like I was involved in conversation on a two-way basis. That's one. Two, I mentioned video. The last is interactivity. There's other things to do to interact with audio content in both a synchronous and asynchronous manner. So I think we're going to evolve the format as we evolve the content. I also think new types of content are going to get really important. You know, we haven't seen a scripted podcast breakthrough in a mass market way. In fact, the biggest scripted podcast I can think of thus far was the Wolverine pod that Disney did a number of years ago with Stitcher. Now, that was kind of the first of its kind, and there hasn't been a big one since, but there will be. And that, as podcasting achieves 50% and 70% domestic market share as an audio product, I think you're going to see more and more excellent creativity. At the same time, you're going to see a lot more flood of supply. And the key thing for us is that we're going to be a good brand filter for where you know, you can organize audience and organize content in a way that's meaningful, which is not to oversell the value of Spotify, but like social media, it's vast until it's not. And I think we're going to try and make the smaller and tighter and more aligned with how you think about the world. At least that's the plan.
Great. Thank you so much. You mentioned Locker Room and our acquisition. I wonder if you could speak more to what that means for fans, creators, advertisers, all the above, how that integration will look and feel like in the future for all of our partners.
Well, the great thing is the brand component's wide open because we're starting to think about it from an audience play in a creative play, which is not to say the commercial won't matter, but like for a brand like Disney, there's things we can do to test activations to see what could work. But I really look at the live audio space in a similar way that I look at like yet another type of camera or another type of microphone. It's another way to organize and connect. You know, something that's going to actually be really cool. And there's still some degree of quality control and trust and safety being thought through. So, you know, we don't want to have live audio and video without some quality control, because that could expose our brand and any brands we're in partnership with to some challenges. So we're trying to think about it through a slightly different lens than I think some of the other platforms out there are doing it, where it's just a place to openly talk about whatever you want. And while I'm totally down to, you know, hear people talk about Bitcoin or psychedelic medicine or whatever they're talking about, I think it's really important that we're focusing on something very deliberate around high value programming and also extending some of our brands into live. And an example, and this is one that I'm not sure is in the room so I could see it, but I could imagine a Radio Disney type program being established with live, where you get this benefit of serendipity and surprise and delight that aligns very well with Disney brand and targeting. But that could be a combination of programming and marketing working together to do something. And trust me, I've been, since I heard that was not going to be as much of an internal focus, I was like, there's such an opportunity for us to kind of think about Disney music in a way, because the power of Disney music is really large. But something like live could recreate some of the benefit that you might have had on a terrestrial radio signal, you know, 10, 20 years ago, but make it really modernized, but also make it controlled. And in some cases, that doesn't have to be time blocks. It could be special events. So I think we can look at it through a lot of different ways. I think it's going to be exciting to present it. We're going to roll it out. I'm going to test a bunch of stuff. A bunch of stuff's not going to work. And then the things that do work, we'll do more of. Things that don't work, we'll pretend like they never happened.
Great. Thank you. Paul, one more question. I think we have time for a couple more. Another question from the Q&A. Do you envision a short versioning happening with podcasts, similar to the short form content explosion we have seen with the video?
The answer is yes and no, meaning like there is a role for both. Short content works for certain contexts. And I think there are people who feel like some podcasts are too long, but I can tell you there are people who will listen to, you know, hardcore histories and it's 3 hours long and that's fine. So I don't think length is the issue. I think length is an opportunity. both to make content work within the context of what that person is looking for. So I do find that, like, when you have 3-hour talk shows, sometimes people definitely do not listen all the way through. You know, a tight 10, tight 20 works if that's the creative concept. We took a show like Science Versus that is a longer show that focuses on science and education, and we made these things called Shots of Science Versus. They were 5-minute edits. And we put them inside of one of our playlists called Your Daily Drive that essentially is a mechanism to build discovery on audio. And it worked really, really well. And it got a lot more people to engage in the show more broadly. So I think there's a role for shorter content, but I think it's not that content has to be shorter to build better connectivity. I think content being predictable and being repeated is a little bit more beneficial than just it being short. So it's really like video, there's different mechanisms that work and we'll try everything. I think for you, sometimes if you need advice on, hey, we're thinking about doing this thing, I will say that we can provide that too. I mean, I would say that that's something that I'm always down to help with, because I know that everybody's trying to think about what role podcasting plays in their portfolio. And I can certainly help you make it great. And I can also help you kind of reinforce what are some of the traps to avoid. But I think that's another role that Spotify can play uniquely with Disney beyond all the other stuff, because we would love to help you.
Great. More of a fun question for Courtney. What was your favorite thing about working at Disney? What was the most challenging, being that you're talking to a group of Disney folks?
Challenging thing. I would say in some cases they're somewhat of the same thing, in that, I'll say two things that are different. The best thing about Disney were the people. I worked with some of the smartest people I've ever gotten to work with. And it's sort of like, I feel like there's an elite class of executive that when you get to senior levels within Disney, the decision makers always inspired me. I'd walk in a room and, you know, you get someone's background and their history, and it was like my jaw was on the floor. And I just love learning from smart people. And I felt like there was a welcomeness in communication in the organization that you typically don't get in big companies. Then the inverse of that is sometimes in order to disrupt your own business, you have to make hard choices. And I found, at least in my time, that there was this existential debate between the old business, the new business, and, you know, various iterations of that. I think it's incredible to see the success that Disney Plus has had. And it's not at the expense of everything else, but that idea that we can release a movie like Loki in the way that you're doing it is so rewarding for everyone, because you're starting to think about consumer first. And I would say that is always a hard existential evolution when you're used to working with distributors and platforms and you don't have all of the control of the consumer relationship and then you want to claw it back. I think that was always a little bit of a tricky challenge within Disney, but needless to say, and this was something obviously I was involved in, but like, I love what's happened in the last couple of years, because it shows that you're clearly on the right track. And while I certainly can take no credit for anything that has happened since I left, I really felt like those early foundational conversations, despite the fact that they were hard, it's amazing to see. And by the way, I'm still a shareholder, so there's that. So I just love that this is still playing itself out. And I'm long Disney, I kept it all.
Love it. I think we have time for one last question before we pivot to the gifting part of the day. So curious on feedback around Disney brands who want to launch multiple podcast concepts, and also feedback around the cadence of the episodes, for example, weekly versus daily. So what would the release cadence look like ideally?
I think it really speaks to what type of show you're doing. I mean, Disney can do lots of things. I think for news and information, being as frequent as possible is beneficial, unless you're doing something like news magazine-y. So I think it's hard for me to answer this on a universal basis, because I've seen daily programming work, I've seen weekly programming work. What I think is harder to do is limited series. If you think about a podcast feed as a social connection, and if you're doing that idea, I said you launch 8, 10, 12 episodes, I think there has to be a longer term commitment to try and make something happen. That said, if it's scripted or it's narrative or it's a form of storytelling, then you have a little bit more leniency in how it can be built. But I think the distribution strategy should be secondary to what is the creative and then why am I doing it? Because that's the main thing, is to do it because you're like, this is a great thing we can do because we're trying to market or promote or create. But then it's really about like, what's the level of commitment you're going to put into it? Because launching it without the support of marketing, without the social promotion, and without a clear understanding of what the creative is, oftentimes will just confuse listeners. It's hard to get a podcast right. It's hard to get one feed right, let alone many. And sometimes it's better to say, let's get one thing really right. And then you can start to build derivatives off of that, which could tee off the feed. And in a way, that's what we've seen work. We worked with Gimlet, started with Startup, then they were able to expand into a portfolio. Even Serial started with This American Life to Serial to then building whole Serial productions. You need something to build off of to grow. So it's like tree branches. What's the root going to be connected to? And then you can build from there. But I do encourage you to think about audio as a viable business, because y'all are great at storytelling, and this is just another medium to do with it.
Great. Thank you so much. We want everyone to be asking, what is your audio strategy for sure? Courtney, Elena, thank you so much for your time. Really appreciate it. Any questions that we didn't answer, feel free to obviously shoot them to me or Nick or Elena, and we'll get those questions answered. But thank you to you both for the panel. I will throw it over to Mr. Guerin to bring us home.
Thanks, Tom. Thanks, Courtney. So welcome, everyone. Thank you guys for making it this far. I'm very excited because this is the most exciting part of the show, because we're giving away some prizes and some awards. So my name is Guerin Markey. I'm a client partner here at Spotify. And if you have not done so already, you can use the QR code right here, as well as the link to Resonate that we have dropped in the chat to make sure that you sign up. That's how we're going to pull in your data to figure out who we are giving out these awards and prizes to. As Anne mentioned at the beginning, one of our prizes is a Bose speaker. So very excited about that. And we'll just give you one quick second to register. And I think my co-host will let me know when we are ready. Here's the QR code again. All right, I think we're ready to go. So we'll head on to the next slide. Okay, Disney. So as we mentioned at the top, we will be analyzing some group information about Disney as a whole. So we're gonna figure out what's behind all the great storytelling and brands and get to the heart of the people in your org. So your group's top artists are Taylor Swift, Billie Eilish, Drake, Dua Lipa, and Khalid. I feel like Taylor Swift is usually in a top five, so no surprise there. We'll head on to the next one. Your top tracks are The One, so I guess we have a lot of folklore fans. I Forget That You Existed, Bad Guy, Ape Shit by the Carters, and Lover by Taylor Swift. So Taylor Swift taking three of the top five here for Disney. And the top genres for the Disney family are pop at 34%. We have rap at 12%, rock at 11%, and EDM at 9%. And then we have a whopping other at 34%. All right, now on to the awards. So we have our social butterfly award. This is the person with the highest number of followers, or potentially maybe the person we're going to recruit to be our next sales rep. And the award goes to Courtney Holt. I don't know if, can Courtney win an award? we'll sort that out later. So power user. So the person with the highest number of playlists. Shane, and I don't want to mess up this last name. Haririan, hipster. So the person with the lowest average popularity of their top 50 tracks. We have Courtney again. The Zen master. So this is the person that I think you guys were all turning to during the pandemic to keep you calm. This is the person with the most Zen playlists. Eugene Rapata. We now have the foodie award. This is the person with the most dining, eating, and food-related playlists. Alex Rossi. And before we get to our next award, we do have a survey that we would love for you to quickly complete. It will take just 2 seconds of your time. And you can rate on a scale from 1 to 10. 1 is very unlikely and 10 is very likely. How likely you are to recommend this event to your colleagues. Give it a 10. All right, so we have our next award, which is the Lights Out. The Lights Out Award. This is the person with the most sleep and night playlists. Eugene, again, wow, we have a lot of, Eugene, you're really cleaning up today. Good job. And that concludes our award ceremony. Thank you everyone for participating. And on behalf of the Spotify team, we just wanna thank you for taking time out of your day and joining. Of course, we will be sharing this presentation with you after the meeting. And if there are any questions, don't hesitate to reach out to your team, whether that's me, Nick Stillwell, or Tom Henry. And we look forward to your continued partnership through the rest of the year. Thank you so much.